When I first saw Holmes and Watson, what is undeniably the worst comedy of recent years, something fascinating happened. So fascinating that I remember my jaw being genuinely just gaped open in shock. And the thing that shocked me, the film had only reached the 2-minute mark in the runtime, and already I felt cripplingly, unbearably bored. And I realized that out of the 3 other people in my screening for this film, 2 of which fell asleep halfway through, and it really doesn't say very good things about your film when 50% of the viewership has genuinely been bored into unconsciousness by the quality of your work. Only this got me thinking, how exactly did Ethan Coen, the writer and director of this masterpiece, manage something no other director had ever done to me before in my entire movie-going life, and bore me so thoroughly, so quickly. Now, we'll get there soon enough, but before we do, I want to say that I've tricked you. I have pulled the old clickbaiteroo, because said the title, this was going to be a video about Holmes and Watson, and well, it is. But this video's title, How to Bore Your Audience, it's hinting at the real topic of this video, and it's one that I have been dying to cover ever since I started this channel almost 2 years ago, and this entire time I've just been waiting for a movie bad enough to give me the excuse to make this video. So to Ethan Coen, thank you for making such a terrible movie and making this educational video possible. So what is the topic of today's video? Well, let me play a few snippets from this film's beginning, and let's see if you can figure it out. So right at the beginning of this movie is a scene in a courtroom, and in our establishing shot, we hear this.
Extra, extra, read all about it! Moriarty's crime spree, over!
Then once we enter the courtroom, we see this.
Mark my words, Sherlock Holmes is on his way. With him, the evidence that will damn you to the noose.
Then we should all pray he arrives soon, for on the strike of noon, I shall have to release this menace.
Now, I could go on and on playing snippet after snippet from this film, but I wonder if just from those 2 clips you can figure out why I was so terrifically bored by the opening of this movie. And the reason? Because this movie is utterly laden with cliché. And also, one thing I found significantly more funny than any of the jokes in this movie is the fact that this film has about 200 attempts at jokes, and roughly I would say that maybe 2 of them actually land and are jokes of conceivable quality. But to add a salt to the wound, as it were, it's this one.
Has made me a master in disguise.
Yeah.
You. What have you done with Sherlock?
Why, Watson?
I never left.
Now, this is probably the most funny joke in this film, or at least I assume so, because by this point in the movie, the 2 guys who fell asleep hadn't woken up, and the 1 other guy in my theatre who was still conscious had just walked out. So I assume it was a funny joke. However, this film's golden joke, the absolute creme of the crop, the best one this writer could come up with, is probably the most tired, overdone and cliché joke that this film has. I mean, TV Tropes has a whole article dedicated to this exact trope because it's been so overdone in fiction, and they call it the paper-thin disguise, and in this article it lists off film after film that uses this incredibly original joke. Basically, it's when a character will dress up in a comically unconvincing attire, and the other characters around them will proceed to be convinced by it. This joke isn't just low-hanging fruit. This joke is fruit that fell off the tree several weeks ago and has been rotting into mulchy brown sludge on the ground, and the wildlife's begun to devour it. Very easy to pick up, just not very satisfying to consume. And this video, I really hope, will be useful for a lot of you writers out there, because clichés are poison. They really are, whether it be in film, TV, or in the novel. When you overuse clichés, they have a deadly effect on the engagement of your audience, as Holmes and Watson did for me. And frankly, the more clichés you have in your work, that will directly decrease the quality of said work. See, the problem I found with clichés is everyone knows they're a bad thing, but most people don't know why they're a bad thing. I mean, what is the reason clichés are bad? What is the reason you should grab your marker pen and aggressively purge your manuscript from them? And to this question, the most common response is, well, they mean the writer hasn't tried. Clichés are overused, and the use of them means the writer lacks imagination, and thus the use of them means the writer is lazy. From what I've seen, that's the most common response to that question, and it's not necessarily wrong. In fact, it's completely right, but I found that it's a really unhelpful answer because it doesn't even address the root of the problem. It's like a child asking his mother, why can't I go play in that abandoned warehouse over there? And to which he responds, well, because it's dangerous. Now, it's a correct answer, it's not wrong, but it's not the ideal answer because it doesn't address the root of the reason. And before we find out what the real reason is, we need to first define exactly what cliché means, and I believe it's a really important question. See, the reason why is because people routinely misdiagnose exactly what a cliché is. I mean, for example, the other day I was listening to a podcast, I won't say whose, but a certain individual said that it's a cliché for your protagonist's parents to be dead before the story begins, therefore you should never do it. But here's the problem. That person is wrong. Dead parents is not a cliché, it's a trope. And something worth remembering is there is nothing wrong with using a trope, but there is something terribly wrong with using cliché. And thusly, it's really important to define the difference. But how do we? There are many people giving their own interpretations out there, but if you ask me, it's this. A trope is a storytelling element that gives the creator license to apply genuine originality. And a cliché is the opposite. It leaves the writer no room to apply said originality. I think that's the most practical way of telling the difference. A cliché, for example, is like saying that he was the bane of her existence, or she froze like a deer in headlights, or it was a dark and stormy night, right? All of those are clichés because they are phrases and metaphors that when you use, you can't really apply original spins to them because you are copying a direct phrase. But okay, how can we prove that those three examples were indeed clichés and not tropes? Okay, so let's say I want to take the phrase, he froze like a deer in headlights, but I want to apply my own original spin to it. How about I write instead, he snapped his head around and stared, much in the same way a deer does moments before it meets a car bonnet. Now, for a lot of newer writers out there, this will be their first instinct. They'll think something along the lines of, oh dear, it seems I have a cliché. Oh, yes, but if I edit it, if I change it, yes, it will cease to be a cliché. But here's the problem. When you edit a tired cliché metaphor, no matter how much you edit it, at its core it is still the exact same tired cliché metaphor. It's like you've bought an old rusty used car and have applied a brand new paint to it. Yes, it looks a little nicer, but anyone who has any experience with cars whatsoever will see straight through exactly what you've done, and they won't be very appreciative to you when you try to sell it to them as a brand new car. You can edit cliches as much as you like, but as my granddad used to say, you can polish that turd as much as you like, but at the end of the day, it's still a piece of shit. And to anyone who's consumed a lot of fiction, your paper-thin disguise will be so thin it's borderline translucent. And they probably won't even see the disguise, they'll just see the original cliché behind it. A general tip, if you're working with a cliché, do not try and salvage it. Do not try and rephrase that cliché to try and give it an original spin. Simply delete it and replace it with something entirely different. Or if you have a line of dialogue that says, mark my words, I will kill you if it's the last thing I do, maybe instead of having that clichéd line, you could come up with an entirely original way of threatening someone, like they did with Liam Neeson in Taken, and by doing so, create your own iconic moment in your fiction. It is extremely hard to come up with these fresh, crisp moments, but if you pull it off, you are bound to impress the audience with your originality. Also, one thing that you can't afford to forget is it's not just sayings and metaphors which are cliché, because there are tons of plot devices and story beats out there which are cliché, because they have been so heavily exhausted. Take, for example, that very court scene we saw in Holmes and Watson. They introduced the idea that when the clock strikes 12, the trial will be thrown out, and that is the final deadline. We have the judge raise his gavel, and mere split seconds before the clock strikes 12, Holmes arrives to save the day. That is a plot element which I think we can all agree is 100% a cliché. But here's the thing. The line between trope and cliché, it can be very blurry, especially when it comes to plot elements. Take for example that scene we've all seen 100 times. There's a timer ticking down, and when it hits zero, something horrible will happen.
Yes, the ticking clock!
Now, I'm sure most of you out there would agree that that's a really tired cliché, where you have the protagonist fighting the villain when just in the nick of time he slaps the shutdown button and stops the bomb or the nerve gas or whatever the horrible thing is, mere seconds or often split seconds before the detonation. But here's the thing, because I can think of one example that uses that very cliché and applies its own original spin to it. So Galaxy Quest is a film that parodies Star Trek. In the climax, they hit the button to stop the ship's explosion, only the clock keeps ticking after they've hit the button. And then it keeps ticking away until just 1 second before it blows up, the timer stops. That's because the aliens who designed the ship designed it in accordance with how it appeared in the fictional show these characters used to be on. And in said show, the timer always stopped 1 second before detonation, because that show used the cliché extensively itself in this kind of meta joke. This makes for a really good laugh from the audience, and honestly, this single moment from Galaxy Quest probably got more laughs than the film Holmes and Watson did in its entirety. And for anyone out there who's never seen Galaxy Quest, what the hell are you doing? By grab Thar's hammer, go watch it right now. But I think that this is where the line between trope and cliche becomes quite grey, because this moment is an original take on that tired cliche, which means, can it even be considered a cliche if it's given its own original spin? Maybe the correct way of interpreting this is, well, the ticking clock is a trope. However, because that trope has been used so extensively, most executions of it are indeed cliché. This is just one of those rare executions that was original. Or maybe this is just flat out cliché, however this example is simply a parody of that cliché, so that's why it works. I honestly don't know, and I'd love to know what you think, so please let me know in the comments down below. Now, we can look at clichés all day, but I think in order to prove my next point, we need to find an example of something that is thoroughly anti-cliché, that is, original. But now, if you'll forgive me, recently I've been reading this book, Leviathan Wakes by James A. Corey, and in this book there was a passage that left me thoroughly impressed by how well it was written. Candace, Miller's ex-wife, had preferred something called Earth Lily, which had always reminded him of the waste recycling levels. These days, he left it to the vaguely astringent smell of the station itself. Recycled air that had passed through a million lungs, water from the tap so clean it could be used for lab work, but it had been piss and shit and tears and blood and would be again. The circle of life on Ceres was so small you could see the curve. Now, when I first read that passage, and I read the line, "The circle of life was so small you could see the curve," I remember taking my head back and I had this massive grin on my face, because it was the antithesis of cliché. It just felt like such a fresh, unique way of describing such a system, and when you think about it, it clicks in your head and makes you understand, because it makes sense. You know, the smaller a circle is, the more obvious its curve, and when you look at the horizon of the Earth, for example, the curve is barely visible because the Earth is so large, or the curve is entirely non-existent, depending on various people out there. But now let's read a paragraph that I just wrote. And before I say it, mandatory disclaimer, it is intentionally terrible. Steve raised his leg and drunkenly hobbled on the other, trying to find the cause of the smell clogging his nose, praying he hadn't stepped in dog shit. As he hopped on his leg, something clicked from the other side of the room. Immediately, light blasted down and stung his sensitive eyes, making him nearly slip and smash his head on the chair. Steve slammed his hand on the table, and once he'd regained his footing, snapped his head around like a deer in headlights. It was his wife, and she glared at the vomit on his shirt, and then the half-drunk bottle in his hand. Now that passage wasn't exactly great. I'm no James A. Corey, but I think we can all agree that the weakest point of that passage was that cliché used towards the end, and when you heard, snapped his head around like a deer in headlights. What did you think? Because I'm willing to bet that you didn't even imagine a deer. You didn't even imagine a grim car ride on a dark night when suddenly the shock of a deer in front of your headlights. I'm willing to bet that the only thing you imagined was Steve simply turning around sharply to see his wife. That's the whole point. This is the reason why clichés are so dangerous. It's not the reason why your creative writing professor tells you. It's not because clichés are lazy. Rather, the reason why you should never use them is because they are so overdone, they have entirely lost their original effect. The core reason why clichés are bad and unoriginality is bad is because every time one sees a thing in fiction, one becomes immunized to it just that little bit, and for every exposure to that element, whether it be a metaphor, a story beat, a character origin, anything, that immunization is exacerbated. I mean, when you come across these clichés in your own work, generally there are two things that you should do. Either A, replace the cliché with a watered-down version of what that cliché means, or B, rewrite that whole little line of dialogue or that little description. So here is an improved version of that last passage. Steve slammed his hand on the table and, once he'd regained his footing, snapped his head around to see a face scowling in the doorway. It was his wife's. She glared at the vomit on his shirt, then the half-drunk bottle in his hands. I think we can all agree that that second example was better than the first, and all I had to do to improve it was simply delete the cliché and replace it with bog-standard prose, he snapped his head around. With a clichéd phrase, it's like the phrase ceases to be a phrase, it becomes just a word, a singular word. Now, I usually focus on film, not prose on this channel, so I'm sorry for delving even further down the rabbit hole, but George Orwell, he once wrote an essay called Politics and the English Language, and in this essay, when touching on clichés, or as he called them back in 1946, dying metaphors, Orwell writes, "As soon as certain topics are raised, the concrete melts into the abstract, and no one seems able to think of turns of speech that are not hackneyed. Prose consists less and less of words chosen for the sake of their meaning, and more of phrases tacked together like the sections of a prefabricated henhouse." And I think in this essay, Orwell really summarizes exactly the problem with clichés, because when a cliché comes along, we don't see the words, we merely see the meaning those words assembled in that formulaic order represent. When a character says, "a fate worse than death," we don't register the phrase and think, "wow, death is pretty bad, but something worse than death? Oh, I can scarcely imagine." The audience will not think that about the phrase. They will simply perceive that as saying, "I'm about to do something very bad to you." The reason why is both those lines mean the exact same thing to the audience and are equally as provocative. Only one is a cliché, the other's not. Now, George Orwell had a lot to say in his day, and he talked about a lot more than just clichés, and he had a point. He believed that the day would come where privacy would cease to exist, where every activity, every word and misstep you take would be recorded and held against you by the all-seeing eye from up above. It's unfortunate for Orwell, however, because if he knew that NordVPN, the sponsor of today's video, was around in the future to save the day, I have no doubt it would have put his mind at ease. Christ, that segue was so clean you could just eat your dinner off it. Anyway, basically what a VPN does is it hides your identity and encrypts all your information online. Whenever you don't use a VPN, almost anyone can see your IP address, which is like your digital fingerprint, and using that address, if they're the company that provides your internet or even your own government, they will know exactly where you are and exactly what you're looking at. I don't know about you, but I would prefer that the only person in the world who knows exactly what I've been looking at be me. Really, in this day and age, if you value your privacy online, you need a good NordVPN, and in my opinion, there is no better one in the market than Nord. What NordVPN does is it uses military-grade encryption on all your data going from your desktop, your laptop, your mobile phone and tablet. Basically, if you have Nord activated on your device, it becomes significantly harder for anyone to know not only where you physically are, but also makes it extremely difficult for anyone to know what you've been looking at. Not only have I been using Nord myself for 2 years at this point, but you'll notice how in that time, I've been sponsored again and again by them in most of my videos. There are hundreds of companies out there doing brand deals on YouTube, and I could be sponsored by any one of them, but I choose to keep working with Nord because I firmly believe that their product is exceptional and that every last one of my viewers would benefit from using their service. And best of all, for the low price of $2.99 a month, you can join me and the thousands of my viewers who have already signed up for this incredible service. And all you need to do is click my link in the description, that's nordvpn.com/theclosereLook, or when you're at the checkout, use the code theclosereLook. And not only will you get this incredible service for less than $3 a month, but also you'll get a free month extra on top for no extra charge. As someone who's been using Nord for years, I can tell you that not only are the connection speeds fast, the interface slick and easy to use, but this service honestly has an insane price at just $2.99 a month. And really, for a price that low to retain your privacy and security online, the word bargain is wrong. It just doesn't do this service justice. This is an absolute steal. So please, click my link in the description, that's nordvpn.com/theclosereLook, or when at the checkout, use my code theclosereLook to secure yourself online today. Anyway, thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys next time on The Closer Look. Wow, death, that's pretty bad, but something worse than death? I can scarcely imagine. Shut up!